Yes. Please.
If there is no God, why do you spend your whole life trying to convince people that there isn't?
Well, it isn't my whole career, for one thing. It's become a major preoccupation of my life, though, in the last 8 or 9 years, especially since September 11, 2001, to try and help generate an opposition to theocracy and its depredations internationally. That is now probably my main political preoccupation, to help people in Afghanistan, in Somalia, in Iraq, in Lebanon, in Israel, resist those who sincerely want to encompass the destruction of civilization and sincerely believe they have God on their side in wanting to do so. A thing, maybe I will take a few minutes just to say something that I find repulsive about especially monotheistic, messianic religion. With a large part of itself, it quite clearly wants us all to die. It wants this world to come to an end. You can tell the yearning for things to be over whenever you read any of its real texts or listen to any of its real, authentic spokesmen, not the sort of the pathetic apologists who sometimes masquerade for it. Those who talk, there was a famous spokesman for this in Virginia until recently, about the rapture, say that those of us who have chosen rightly will be gathered to the arms of Jesus, leaving all of the rest of you behind. If we're in a car, it's your lookout. That car won't have a driver anymore. If we're a pilot, that's your lookout. That plane will crash. We will be with Jesus, and the rest of you can go straight to hell. The eschatological element that is inseparable from Christianity, if you don't believe that there is to be an apocalypse, there is going to be an end, a separation of the sheep and the goats, a condemnation, a final one, then you're not really a believer. And the contempt for the things of this world shows through all of them. It's well put in an old rhyme from an English exclusive brethren sect. It says that we are the pure and chosen few, and all the rest are damned. There's room enough in hell for you. We don't want heaven crammed. You can tell it when you see the extreme Muslims talk. They cannot wait. They cannot wait for death and destruction to overtake and overwhelm the world. They can't wait for what I would call, without ambiguity, a final solution. When you look at the Israeli settlers, paid for often by American tax dollars, deciding that if they can steal enough land from other people and get all the Jews into the promised land and all the non-Jews out of it, then finally the Jewish people will be worthy of the return of the Messiah. And there are Christians in this country who consider it their job to help this happen so that Armageddon can occur, so that the painful business of living as humans and studying civilization and trying to acquire learning and knowledge and health and medicine and to push back can all be scrapped, and the cult of death can take over. That, to me, is a hideous thing in eschatological terms, in end times terms, on its own. A hateful idea, a hateful practice, and a hateful theory, but very much to be opposed in our daily lives, where there are people who sincerely mean it, who want to ruin the good relations that could exist between different peoples, nations, races, countries, tribes, ethnicities, who openly say they love death more than we love life, and who are betting that with God on their side, they're right about that. So when I say, as the subtitle of my book, that I think religion poisons everything, I'm not just doing what publishers like and coming up with a provocative subtitle. I mean to say it infects us in our most basic integrity. It says we can't be moral without Big Brother, without a totalitarian permission. It means we can't be good to one another. It means we can't think without this. We must be afraid. We must also be forced to love someone who we fear. The essence of sadomasochism, the essence of abjection, the essence of the master-slave relationship, and that knows that death is coming and can't wait to bring it on. I say this is evil, and though I do some nights stay home, I enjoy more the nights when I go out and fight against this ultimate wickedness and ultimate stupidity. Thank you.
Okay, let me see. I don't think it's going to take 10 minutes to disprove the existence of God. The atheist proposition is the following, most of the time. It may not be said that there is no God. It may be said that there is no reason to think that there is one. That was the situation after Lucretius and Democritus and the original anti-theistic thinkers began their critique of religion. And I would just ask you all, ladies and gentlemen, to bear in mind a mild distinction while we go on. You may wish to be a deist, as my heroes Thomas Jefferson and Thomas Paine were, and you may not wish to abandon the idea that there must be some sort of first or proximate cause or prime mover of the known and observable world and universe. But even if you can get yourself to that position, which we unbelievers maintain is always subject to better and more perfect and more elegant explanations, even if you can get yourself to that position, all your work is still ahead of you. To go from being a deist to a theist, in other words, from someone who says, God cares about you, knows who you are, minds what you do, answers your prayers, cares which bits of your penis or clitoris you saw away or have sawn away for you, minds who you go to bed with and in what way, minds what holy days you observe, minds what you eat, minds what positions you use for pleasure, all your work is still ahead of you, and lots of luck. Because there's nobody, even Aquinas had to give it up. There's no one who can move from the first position to the second. So I could, and I'm actually strongly tempted to, I could leave it right there. But then it's not in my nature to let off a captive audience so easily. The reasons for atheism, or as I would prefer to say, anti-theism, are, I would say, as follows. The first and the simplest objection to religious belief is that its metaphysical claims are not true, in fact are false, and come from a period that I would describe as the infancy or the fearful childhood of our species, when, because we have brains that seek for information and seek for explanation, brains that even now prefer a conspiracy theory to no theory at all and are bound to do so, and indeed in some ways are right to seek in this way, explanations had to be found for things that seemed at the time inexplicable and in the absence of crucial information. We didn't know, we had no way to know that the Earth went around the sun. Didn't know that there was a germ theory that would explain disease. Didn't have any means of knowing that earthquakes were the result of living on the crust of a cooling planet in a rather odd solar system where most of the planets are either too hot or too cold to support life, and our own is in large part too hot or too cold to support it either, and where the remainder lives on a climatic knife edge and always has. Some design, by the way, and that's just of one solar system. We didn't know that matters of this kind, earthquakes, waves, disasters, were not punishments. It was quite possible to listen to those and even to believe those who thought that they could explain. But for these people, a double problem arises. There is first the difficulty of, if not the impossibility, of demonstrating the existence of any creator or designer at all. I think I say something uncontroversial when I say that no theologian has ever conclusively demonstrated that such a designer can or does or ever has existed. The most you can do by way of the argument from design is to infer him or her or it from an apparent harmony in the arrangements. And this was at a time when that was the very best that, so to speak, could be done. But religion goes a little further than this already rather impossible task and expects us to believe as follows: that the speaker not only can prove the existence of the said entity, but can claim to know this entity's mind. In fact, can claim to know it quite intimately, can claim to know his or her personal wishes, can in turn tell you what you may do in his name.
a quite large arrogation of power, you will suddenly notice, is being granted to the speaker here. The speaker can tell you that he knows, he cannot tell you how, but he can tell you that he knows, for example, that heaven hates ham. That God doesn't want you to eat pork products. He can tell you that God has a very, very strong view about with whom you may have sexual relations, indeed, how you may have sexual relations with others. He can indicate, perhaps a little less convincingly, but no less firmly, that there are certain books or courses of study that you might want to avoid or treat with great suspicion. Now, this suggests to me already a design. I think I can see a design shaping up here, and I think I can see who designed it and created it. I think it was man-made. I think the whole inference, because you can certainly see a design at work, is that this is human. That it was designed at a time of great distress and great ignorance, and that it had an enormous advantage, the design of which can be inferred from every one of its practices. It gives to people, ministers, priests, rabbis, shamans, whoever's cell phone that is should know that we know where you live, by the way, and where your children go to school. It gives to those people power in the here and now, the only place where it really counts. If you are His Holiness the Pope and you have arrogated to yourself, for example, the power to bind and to loose and to decide who may read what and how many tithes must be paid, how many holy days must be observed, how many disciplines must be followed, are you seeking power in the hereafter or are you seeking it now? It seems to me very obvious that, inescapable conclusion, that it's temporal power that's being talked about. And of a very dictatorial kind, I might add, an absolutist kind, a kind that is not open to the ordinary challenges. The divine right of kings was something you had to challenge not just at the risk of your life, which might end quickly, though the end itself would be slow and painful, the end would be final, but you were told you risked your immortal soul and the rest of your life too. That's quite a powerful instrument of secular discipline. And everyone can name their favorite example, I think, of how and where that kind of tyranny over the minds as well as the bodies of men was exerted. We think of it as belonging to our prehistory, but we only have to look as far as today's Iran, for example, to see a classic theocracy, a country from which I've recently returned, where I wonder how to convey sometimes the flavor of what theocracy really is like. Well, if you're a woman who gets in trouble with the regime and has committed a capital offense in Iran, but you're underage, you're a virgin, you may not be sentenced to death under the law of Iran because the law forbids the execution of virgins. But you may be raped by the Revolutionary Guards so that you're no longer a virgin in the prison and then executed. I think that sort of conveys what people feel they're allowed to do when they think they have God on their side. And I could tell you far worse than that about what the arrogance of power is when it thinks it's backed by the divine. Well, this arrogation of power in the material world is really nothing compared to the dictatorship that is suggested by those who infer the whole celestial design that backs it. That's why I want to spend a moment or two telling you why I'm an anti-theist. You may be an atheist and wish that there was a God who loved you and took care of you. It's possible. But just to decide there isn't enough evidence for it, just as Mr. Jefferson was a deist but didn't believe in religion. He didn't think God intervened. These positions are equally compatible. I know several atheists who would happily say that they wish it were true, but that they can't find that it is believable. My own view is that it's very fortunate for us that it isn't true, and I shall say why. If there was a supervising creator who took a personal interest in your life, what you would have from the moment of your conception, at least in one interpretation, would be a permanent, inescapable, unchangeable, unalterable, unchallengeable rule, which would involve round-the-clock surveillance and supervision of every single waking and sleeping moment of your life. The abolition of any privacy in your life or even in your mind and your most private thoughts. The most complete form of totalitarianism ever imagined. and indecent, too, when you think of how many private moments would have to be supervised in this way and invigilated permanently. And that would go on not just for the rest of your life, as it would if you lived in Iran. It would go on after you died. In fact, after you died, the real invigilation would begin. They'd only have started with you at the moment when you left this Vale of Tears. The two offers are, at that point, as you will know, at least from all two of the leading monotheisms, either an eternity of praise and servility, everlasting praise and adoration of someone who has only done his job by creating you, hasn't been invited to do so, proposition that sounded more like hell to me when I first heard about it, or a very much more unpleasant one, derived not from the Old Testament but from the New. There's no hell in the Old Testament. There's genocide, there's racism, there's slavery, there's child mutilation, there's everything else you could wish for, but there's no punishment of the dead. Not until the arrival of the gentle Nazarene is it suggested that for a crime you probably were forced to commit, because after all, you're created a sinner. You're created sick and commanded to be well, the essence of the totalitarian principle. But for that, you might face an eternity of torture, to which there'll be no end. Now, I think this is a horrible proposition. I think those who wish for it are wishing for slavery and servility, for the abdication of their own responsibility, for the dissolution of their minds, the abolition of their individuality. I'm therefore very glad to say that there is no evidence for it at all. We can relax. And one way of demonstrating beyond very much doubt that it is man-made is its proliferation. We have, I think, two choices here, either man-made God or God-made man. If it's the former, nothing much remains to be explained. If it's God-made man, it's very hard to see why there are so many religions and why they're constantly at war with one another. Make the opposite assumption that man has invented religion and God. Nothing is left to be explained. There is no mystery. There are, of course, innumerable proliferating cults, sects, confessional discrepancies, warring churches, schismatic groups. Most of the violence in Iraq, as we know, is not directed at our own brave soldiers and their allies among Iraqis, but at other Iraqis who, by other Muslims, who think it's cultural to blow up each other's mosques, something a secularist would never agree to do, to blow up, say, the Golden Dome at Samarra. We know from pre-monotheistic times, we know from Sophocles and Antigone, that any person of ordinary morality has a natural resistance to desecration, to profanity. We wouldn't do that. We'll leave it to the religious to do it, which you always can. The last time American troops were needed in a context like this, it was because the Christians of Bosnia and Herzegovina and Croatia were tearing each other's throats out, burning each other's churches, killing each other's children, all of it with a divine warrant. All of them, every last one of them, a faith-based. On that occasion, the Muslims were the most civilized people in the case. It doesn't make any difference. Almost everybody gets, as it were, their turn at bat to be the most intolerant among the religious. But to say that this is man-made is, it seems to me, to say something that's almost obvious.
So three was right. Dr. Turek.
Okay.
Christopher, what is your explanation for the beginning of time, space, and matter out of nothing?
Well, we don't know. I remember being asked by one of my children once when I said, well, what was there at the Big Bang? And I said, well, you have to imagine. This shows how poverty-stricken our own vocabulary is, and I suspect how poverty-stricken our own capacity is. In other words, I think there are some things, not that we don't understand or know, but that we cannot. So we're reduced to sort of primitive images. But I said, suppose you could picture all of matter, the whole of matter, condensed into, I got this from Hawking, I think, one of his colleagues, condensed into something like a very small, dense, black suitcase of the kind you see people carrying money in crime thrillers. And it's about to fly open. That's what you'd have to be able, and everything that's ever going to be is inside that. That was the best I could do. And I don't think many people could do, if I say it myself, that much better. But I was completely unhorsed because the kid said, well, what was outside the suitcase? And I thought, oh, well, I can't do that. And I don't know anyone who can. And that, in a way, would be my whole point. I don't have to know. You do. You're the one who says you know, not me. The theist and the deist say, oh, come on, we know. This is only possible with an author. It's only possible with a creator. It's only possible with a master and commander. It's only possible with a dictator. You're welcome. I don't need 5 minutes.
Is it fair to say, though, that if the creation was out of nothing, and that's the common view today, that the being that brought it into existence, the cause, whatever it was...
Don't say being. What ground do you have to say being?
Because to go from a state of non-existence to a state of existence, you need to make a choice.
No, you don't.
You don't. How does something that...
Where are you getting this choice from?
The choice... How does a... first of all, there was no nature. There was nothing. So if there was nothing, how do you get something from nothing without a cause?
How do you get... I can answer the same question in the way I did before. How do you get so much nothing from something? You look into the night sky. If you're in, say, the Carmel Peninsula, you can't do it from many parts of Virginia now, but if you are in certain parts of California, as I was recently, you can look into the night sky and see universes blowing up and bursting into flame every night of the week, several times. They had something, and it's all nothing now. Who's the author of that? Who mandated that? Who's the creator of that? Who's the dictator who demands that sacrifice?
The fact that things...
You're making a rod for your own back here.
No, the fact that things go out of existence, Christopher, doesn't mean that they're not designed. The typewriter is out of existence right now, thankfully. But the typewriter's designed. So the fact that the universe is going to heat death doesn't mean that it didn't have a designer at the beginning. And, of course, religious people believe that somebody's going to intervene to stop it before it does go. And even if...
Oh, they do?
Even if it doesn't...
Wait.
Even if nobody intervenes...
If it goes to heat death, it goes to heat death. Excuse me. Did the religious among you, ladies and gentlemen, understand, I did not, that there will be an intervention to make an exception in our case? That this will not happen to our cosmos? That God will prevent the heat death?
That's the Christian view, and as I said...
I had no idea.
Yes. That a new heaven and new earth will be created. Genesis is paradise lost. Revelation is paradise restored.
It sounds fatuous to me, I've got to say.
Again, how do you get something from nothing?
I am not the one who has to answer the question. Excuse me, you're the one who has to answer the question. You're the one who claims to know. You say there was a creation moment and a creator. I want to know why you're changing the subject and saying to me, how do I not know this, when you're the one who has all the information? I want to know what sources you have that are not available to me. How do you know that an intervention will occur to prevent the entropy and implosion and destruction of our solar system?
If you want to go to our second debate, I'll provide that. But what I'm saying is let's say there's no intervention. Let's say there's no intervention. We go to heat death. Does that mean that the universe was not created and not designed?
It doesn't entail that belief, no, but it makes it...
Okay, so what's your
point?
It
makes it seem a very capricious designer. Shall we say, rather as I said, it's an old verse of Phil Greville's, created sick, commanded to be well. Why would people be told, okay, I can create you, but I'm going to create you with original sin, misery, shame, death of children, disease, and so on, just to see if you can pass a test that would mean I might not send you to hell? I don't say that that didn't happen. I say that I'm very glad that the evidence for it is very scanty. And I accuse those of who do believe it, and I can't have been surely misunderstood on this point, of harboring a very sinister desire to live in a totalitarian system.
How do you define sinister?
Mr. Hitchens.
The desire to be a slave. I'll say that I think masochism is a sinister and creepy impulse, yes.
Mr. Hitchens.
And I give publicity and exposure whenever I can to those who were brave enough in old times to oppose this nightmarish belief. And one of the great opponents of the Islamic totalitarianism in ancient Persia was the great Omar Khayyam, perhaps the greatest poet of old Persia, whose Rubaiyat, I'm sure, is known at least to some of you. And my favorite verse of this comes from the Robert Le Gallienne translation, and it takes the form of a question. The quatrain is in the form of a question. It says, "And do you think that unto such as you, a maggot-minded, starved, fanatic crew, God gave a secret and denied it me? Well, well, what matters it? Believe that too." To this magnificent astronomer and scientist and physician and humanist of Persia, who opposed the cruel, sadistic, verminous, ignorant mullahs of his day, I borrow the question. What is your authority for saying that you know something that I don't?
Christopher, I'm giving a probability argument. As you said before, you can't disprove the existence of God, and you can't prove beyond any doubt that there's a God. I'm giving probability. I'm giving cosmological, teleological, moral, consciousness, reason, mathematics, all of those things I listed before. It's open. The evidence is open to everybody. And this is related to your 70,000 years point that you just made there. From a Christian perspective, God has always had a revelation, even before Christ. It talks about the fact that God has always had a witness. There's three witnesses. There's creation. Everyone has creation. There's conscience. Everyone has conscience. And there's Christ. Now, Christ, true, only came 2,000 years ago. But his sacrifice of atonement, his sacrifice of atonement is retroactive to everybody that lived before him. So he's always had a witness. It is quite convenient, and that is the very nature of God. You're absolutely correct.
Well, I got him to say it. You see, if we were only discussing ontological questions, that would be all very well, and it could be quite amusing. I could say that you require a higher degree of standard of proof for your proposition than I perhaps do for mine, and you'd probably accept that, and so forth, and we could go back and forth. But we'd be paltering again with the essence of the matter, which is this. The difference between the theist and the deist is as follows. The deist says, may not make sense without some kind of designer. The theist says, when I tell you what to do, Christopher, I have God on my side. The deist says, he can tell what God wants of me, what length I should shave off the end of my penis, if I'm a boy, or have a male child, or off the clitoris if it's a female child. He knows through the exactitude what the proportions of that should be, what the diet should be, what the dietary laws ought to be, who I should sleep with, and in what position. And various other things. And since God doesn't ever directly appear and say, do it this way, it's done for him, and this is really convenient, by human representatives who claim to act in his name. So that's why I think your standard of proof should be a great deal higher, because the reason this point is important to you is because it would mean real power in the only world that actually exists, which is the material world, of you over me. And you wonder why I'm not keen.
Okay, the material world is all that exists. That thought that you just mentioned, Christopher, the material world that all that exists, is that thought material? And if it is, why is it true?
That sounds like casuistry to me, but I mean, I certainly think that that everything that I am capable of thinking, saying, feeling, and so forth does depend on my continued existence as a, what shall we say, mass of molecules or... Shoot me in the head, and I can't go on like this. 'Well, since I answered your last question with a question of my own, I'll make it my question to you. I'm very keen to know how it is that you, in a sense, that you dare to say that without a belief in religion, I would have no source for ethical or moral.
It's not what I'm saying.
You seem to hint at it.
No.
Did he not?
No. Oh, I'm not saying you don't know morality, Christopher. I'm saying you can't justify morality without a being beyond yourself.
So that, just if I, okay, good. So that if I say that for me it's enough to be willing to love my fellow man and perhaps hope that my fellow man and woman will give me some of the same consideration in return, and that After all, the Samaritan, of whom we've all heard, was the only one to help after the priests and the Levites had passed by. And the Samaritan also, though he's talked of by Jesus, can't have been a Christian because he appears in a story told by Jesus, so there can't be any Christianity before that. Somehow, he knew the moral thing to do is to help his fellow person without a religious instruction.
Yes, that's
and that's actually the whole point of the parable, though it's not the way it's usually told.
And that's what Christianity teaches. You know morality. It's written on your heart. You don't need the scripture to know right from wrong.
And this was only available to us 2,000 years ago.
No. You've known it from the beginning of time. Conscience has been on humanity from forever.
You'll have to let me press you a little bit on that. I mean, William Ewart Gladstone spent a huge amount of his life, and he was a great scholar of Latin and Greek, showing that every one of the Greek Socratic and other moral precepts, all they were just prefigurations of Christianity. These are the best the Greeks could do before Jesus arrived.
Because
he couldn't face the idea that these solidarities and moralities and understandings are innate in people and don't require divine permission. I just have to ask you, if you could do it plainly, which side do you come down on? Do you think we need divine permission to act humanly to each other?
No, it has nothing to do with permission. It has to do with the ontological category known as morality. Where does morality come from? Does it come from the benzene molecule, the carbon molecule, the oxygen molecule? In your worldview, where does it come from?
Suppose that we were having this discussion before the existence of molecules was understood.
It's irrelevant.
No, it's not, because the discussion about where does the good come from was being conducted before Lucretius developed the atomic theory, before Democritus and Epicurus, I should better say, understood that the whole world was made up of atoms and molecules. Before that was known, people were arguing, why do we behave one way to our fellows, and we call it good, and another way, and we call it wicked?
Because it's written
the
on...
Molecular, the molecular, you can't, I don't think you can build in a molecular distraction to that.
I don't have the molecular problem, you do. So you're a materialist. I'm trying to ask you, where does morality come from in a materialistic worldview?
Well, did I not just acquit myself of that charge and say that the argument precedes the knowledge of the atomic and molecular structure?
No, it doesn't. No.
Not that I think, by the way, that the atomic and molecular structure is irrelevant, and it could be that we might find out that there are, who knows, pheromones or this or other phenomena that do have an influence on our moral conditioning. This still wouldn't, to a morally normal person, relieve them of the responsibility of saying that I feel I know what's right. I feel that some things my children don't need to be told; they already know.
Let me interject here and just ask a question another way.
To tell a child, you go to this church, which means you'll go to heaven, but your little playmates don't go to that church, and therefore will go to hell, seems to me to be an unpleasant thing to be saying.
But yes, that is.
Maybe I'm in a minority then.
That could be an unpleasant thing, but how do you...
Actually an evil thing,
let's,
you say.
Let's call it evil,
only,
Christopher.
And something that only a religious person would dream of saying.
Let's call it evil. Where does evil come from?
Religion. To answer your next question, morality comes from humanism and is stolen by religion for its own purposes.
Humanism according to who? Hitler, Mussolini, Stalin, who?
You're saying that Hitler was a humanist?
Just Hitchens.
I've lived to hear it said.
Hitchens.
In Virginia. Hitler was a Catholic.
Hitler
was a Catholic, so was Mussolini.
Give me a... How does morality exist
both
if it's just my opinion against
them,
your
both
opinion?
Both of them had
and
an official political
no
concordat with the Protestant and Catholic churches. Both of them wanted the worship of themselves as well as of God.
So I suppose no evil comes
and
from
their
atheism.
Their third main ally, Hirohito, the Emperor of Japan, not content just to be theocratic, was himself a god. So anyone who says that fascism and Nazism were secular is an ignoramus.
Why is it
on
wrong?
A gigantic scale?
I'm asking an ontological question.
I'm not going to be called a Hitlerite because I'm a humanist. Okay?
I'm not asking a sociological question. All right. Let me ask a question another way. This is my last question. If God does not exist, why do all people have a fixed moral obligation to love and not murder? How do molecules in motion have any authority to tell you how to behave? When you do something wrong, whose standard are you breaking? Who are you displeasing? The carbon atom, the benzene molecule, who?
This question has been asked. Socrates answered it like this when he was on trial for his life. Accused of blasphemy, by the way. He said that he had an inner daemon, was the way he put it. Not demon, a daemon, a spirit, an inner critic, a conscience would be one way of putting it. And that he knew enough to know, even when he was making the best speech of his life, that if he was making a point that was somehow dishonest or incomplete or shady, the daemon would tell him, yeah, that was clever, but you shouldn't have tried it. He knew. Okay? Any person of average moral equipment has the same knowledge, I hope you'll. If you don't, I'm very sorry for you. Adam Smith called it the internal witness, who we all have to have a conversation with all the time. It's been C.S. Lewis decided to call it conscience and to attribute it to the divine, but he didn't improve on what Adam Smith said in the Theory of Moral Sentiments or what Socrates said when standing trial for his own life. It's been sometimes colloquially defined as, why do people behave well when nobody's looking? I don't believe there's anyone in this hall who doesn't know what I mean by that. Why, when it won't do you any good, will you decide, I could have kept that wallet I found on the back of the cab seat, but I'm not going to. I'm going to turn it in. I'm going to find its real possessor. There are people to whom those thoughts do not occur, who are deaf to that idea, who only think of themselves, who wouldn't worry about the internal daemon or censor or companion. And there are, of course, people who only get pleasure from being unpleasant to other people and inflicting cruelty on them. The first group we call the sociopathic, and the second group we call the psychopathic. And they occur in nature and in society. My only problem is with those who think that they're all made in the image of God. The one explanation that absolutely doesn't work at all, that gets you nowhere, that explains nothing.
Do you want me to answer that or not? That's for somebody else, okay.
If Christianity is true, then why aren't the differences that Jesus makes in the lives of Christians more powerful or evident than the impact other religions make on their adherents?
I don't know if I accept the premise of the question.
Well, the questioner adds, Gandhi was every bit as influential as any Christian.
Yeah, that's true, and that's one of the problems with Christianity. The biggest problem with Christianity is Christians. I admit it.
But the questioner is asking a more central question, which is, if this is the truth,
yes,
why then doesn't that truth, by the weight of its infinite being, cause its adherents to behave in a way that we can all notice?
Well, I think you can notice it in several Christians. I think Christians for years have been the ones that have built hospitals and cared for the poor and cared for the weak and the sick. So I think it does make a difference. My problem, which is part of the problem that the questioner is asking, is why doesn't it have this effect on everyone? And I'll throw a little Christian theology in here. The problem isn't that we don't have all the Holy Spirit. We do. We just don't allow all the Holy Spirit to do what it should do. It's our problem. We are fallen human beings. And that's why Christ had to come, because we are fallen human beings.
And has to come again, because he didn't get it right the first time. I agree. I agree with you that the grammar of the question is wrong. But for a different reason, I don't see what's moral about Christian preaching. For example, apart from the horrible idea of vicarious redemption, I'll say again, in case I missed you the first time, what I mean by that. I could pay your debt, even if I didn't know you. If I was a friend, I could say, you're in debt, I'll pay. In extreme cases, people have been known to say, I'll serve your sentence in prison. I could do that for you. What I cannot do is relieve you of your responsibility. I can't say, throw your sins on me, they'll melt away. Immoral. People are not allowed to be. They're not entitled to be relieved of their responsibilities. And the vicarious redemption by human sacrifice is a very primitive and horrible scapegoating idea that belongs to the barbaric period of human history.
So all pardons are immoral?
No, not all pardons. No, I didn't say that. I said vicarious redemption is an immoral doctrine. It's also immoral of the Nazarene to say, take no thought for the morrow, not to clothe, not to eat, not to invest, don't leave your family, leave your children, leave everything, give up the world, no investment, no thrift, no thought for the future, just follow me. That's only moral if you are a sure believer in the idea that the world is about to come to an end, which was the case with this apocalyptic...
I guess you never read the parable of the talents,
huh? He said the prophecy is that the world is coming to an end real soon. There's no point in caring about anything else. That's not a moral preaching to me at all. There are many other ways in which I fail to see how any bad behavior can ever be described as un-Christian. And of course, it's completely laughable to say Christians build hospitals. As many Christians have bombed hospitals as have built them, and as many Muslims have built hospitals as Christians have, and as many Babylonians have built great buildings as Christians have. If that's the best you can do, that's the best you can do.
Well, a member of the audience takes issue with your claim that objective morality necessarily relies in an absolute deity, asking instead, what about empathy, for which there are significant apparent biological bases?
Sorry, I didn't hear that. What about
empathy, for which there are fairly well-established biological bases? A very human emotion. Cannot empathy lead to morality?
Is it right to be empathetic? That's the question. I'm not saying there's no chemical connection between morality and, or for morality, I should say. There are chemicals going on. The question is, what is the standard that makes empathy or love right? What is the chemical composition of love? How much does justice weigh?
Well,
these are all things that make no sense in a materialistic world.
But that's not entirely true. Let's say, for example, that cognitive neuroscientists are able to determine with scientific levels of precision that, in fact, certain neurochemical and cognitive events always co-occur with the experience of empathy.
But that wouldn't mean that empathy's right. See, there may be chemical compositions that cause that guy to chop that guy's head off on the Canadian bus. That wouldn't make it right. The question is, what makes something right? In a materialist worldview, there's nothing that can make something right or wrong. As David Hume has said, you cannot get an ought from an is.
Well, I'm happy to agree with that. I mean, I think that's true. But I have to add only that some of us have been lucky enough to see it or meet people who've done it, and all of us have read about it. There are people who will, when a grenade is lobbed through the window, throw themselves on it before it can blow up. It does happen. There are people who die under torture without giving away the whereabouts of their comrades. There are people who go do bomb disposal work and sit defusing huge device. They know any minute. It does happen. It's always happened. It's common to every known human society. It's a part of every heroic narrative of every known society there's ever been. Those who do it are honored. They are sung, as we say, in the times when there was no literal record. And it doesn't require divine sanction or permission. It is, we're proud to say, if not innate in us, we'd be too humble to say that. It's innate in our species. It's something we can all aspire to.
Yes, you
but
know
we
it.
We do not get it from Big Brother. If we did, that would degrade it. It would mean it wasn't heroic. It wasn't brave. It wasn't individual. It wasn't exemplary.
Why are these things good?
Didn't deserve anything. Because it would be in the hope either of a reward from Big Brother or for fear of punishment from it. It would abolish morality.
Why?
It destroys ethics. It means the individual example is dust.
Christopher, you've already abolished morality by your materialistic worldview. There's no such thing as morality if you're just a bunch of chemicals.
Wait a second. It's okay. I already know some people will clap anything. Do you mean to say that the human, the body of a mammal, a primate, is not a chemical composition?
No, it is.
Oh, good.
I'm questioning where
why do you act as if this has only just been discovered and as if it's a theological point?
Because you apparently haven't discovered that morality...
I would rather say, in spite of the fact that I am a primate, notwithstanding, perhaps I'd better say, that I'm a primate, nonetheless, I'm capable of thinking about heroism, self-sacrifice, example, and so forth.
Why are all those things good?
Don't turn to me and say, how can you say that and be a primate?
Why are they good?
I can't alter the fact that I'm a primate. I can conceal it better than some people can. That's the best I can do.
You're a primate as well,
and you'll have to agree with both of us that it shows.
One of the questioners repeats a point from Dr. Turek's opening statement that apparently he or she feels you did not address, Mr. Hitchens, about the irreducible complexity of DNA. And is it possible for such structures to have formed by chance?
Well, I have two responses to that. One is, what would she have said before she knew about DNA?
What does that have to do with anything? They existed prior to anyone knowing about them.
Yes.
Gravity existed before we knew about it,
that's
Christopher.
Correct.
You need an explanation
that's
for that.
That's correct. And Christianity thought it could explain everything, and then it found there were more things. Wait. This is a very simple, same as your point about molecules, that I said that these arguments predate Epicurus, Lucretius, and the atomic theory. Christianity used to say it can explain everything. All you need to know is there's an all-powerful, all-loving, all-intervening, all-knowing, omniscient God. Okay, well then, wait, wouldn't DNA explain more? Well, that only shows that God's even cleverer than we thought. So it's an infinitely expanding tautology. There are some Christians who accept, in fact, it was actually a Catholic physicist at the University of Louvain in Belgium who first came up with the idea of what we now call the Big Bang. And most popes, not all, but most popes have accepted it. Some have thought of it as a challenge to Christianity. The Pope Leo, who he went to, I can't remember the scientist's name for a second, maybe someone here can help me. He went to the Pope and said, look, it looks like this is how things started. And the Pope said, if you like, I'll make it a dogma that every Catholic has to believe it. He said, that would be slightly missing the point, Your Holiness.
Christopher, what does this have to do with the origin of DNA?
Well, because it is true to say that religion, as Stephen Jay Gould said, that religion and science belong to non-overlapping magisteria. I think these magisteria are in many ways incompatible and in many ways irreconcilable, but it is no more true to say that the existence of the complexity of DNA shows that God was more ingenious than we thought than it is to say that it necessarily shows by its self-revealing ingenuity that we don't need the hypothesis of God. Both of these positions would be, in my opinion, somewhat reductionist, though I would have to say that I think the second one is more persuasive and more elegant.
Now, Gould is wrong.
Will that do?
Christians or religious people, religion is trying to find out how the universe began, and so is science. They're not...
No, religion says it does know, excuse me.
No, it's trying to find...
Religion is not a process of scientific inquiry. Religion is an affirmation of faith. It says it
already
knows.
I am a religious person, Christopher, and I am using evidence to try and point out that the universe exploded into being out of nothing.
And you have scientific evidence for the view that an intervention will occur to prevent the implosion and
entropy. No, forget that. Let's start at the beginning.
I can't forget it.
Let's start at the beginning. That's for debate, too.
It's the only thing you've said all evening that I'm going to remember.
Gentlemen.
That's for debate, too.
No. I mean... Don't say, look, do yourself and your faith the honor of saying it's faith. Don't say it's science-based.
The argument
you
would
won't
be...
You won't get away with it.
Look, the argument would be, Christopher, is that if the universe exploded into being out of nothing, then miracles are possible because the greatest miracle of all has already occurred. The question is, have miracles occurred in the first century?
Miracle,
that requires another debate whereby we have to look at the historical evidence and see. And if it is true that... that Jesus really did come and say and do the things that the New Testament writer said he did, then whatever he teaches is true, because if he rose from the dead, he was God. If he taught that there will be an intervention, then there will be. That's the argument. I don't have time to support it.
Very good. Now, a sentence or two from David Hume would correct what you said. A miracle is defined not as a part of the natural order, but as a suspension of the natural order.
No, an intervention.
You can't say of the Big Bang, which is the foundation of the natural order, that it's a suspension of what it starts. You may not do that. However, If you meet someone in the street who you yesterday saw executed, you can say either that an extraordinary miracle has occurred or that you are under a very grave misapprehension. And David Hume's logic on this, I think, is quite irrefutable. He says, what is more likely, that the laws of nature have been suspended in your favor and in a way that you approve, or that you've made a mistake? And in each case, you must, and especially if you didn't see it yourself and you're hearing it from someone who says that they did. I would go further and say the following. I'll grant you that it would be possible to track the pregnancy of the woman Mary, who's mentioned about three times in the Bible, and to show that there was no male intervention in her life at all. But yet she delivered herself of a healthy baby boy. I can say, I don't say that's impossible. Parthenogenesis is not completely unthinkable, but it does not prove that his paternity is divine. And it wouldn't prove that any of his moral teachings were thereby correct. Nor, if I was to see him executed one day and see him walking the streets the next, would that show that his father was God, or his mother was a virgin, or that his teachings were true, especially given the commonplace nature of resurrection at that time and place. After all, Lazarus was raised, never said a word about it. The daughter of Jairus was raised, didn't say a thing about what she'd been through. And the Gospels tell us that at the time of the crucifixion, all the graves in Jerusalem opened, and their occupants wandered around the streets to greet. So that it seems the resurrection was something of a banality at the time. Not all of those people clearly were divinely conceived. So I'll give you all the miracles, and you'll still be left exactly where you are now, holding an empty sack.
No, Christopher, you have to look at each miracle in light of the evidence and the context. Hume was wrong, because his premise that was wrong was the one that said the evidence for the regular is always greater than that for the rare. It's not. From Hume's own worldview, if Hume was here today, he wouldn't even believe in the Big Bang because it only happened once. It's not a regular event, it happened once. He wouldn't believe in the spontaneous generation of life, which is what a materialist must believe, because it only happened once. He wouldn't believe in his own birth because it only happened once. In fact, he wouldn't be able to believe in the whole history of our solar system because it only happened once. You don't need regular events to know whether or not something happened. Singular events happen all the time. This debate will never happen again, yet you're here to witness it.
I'm just going to repose my trust in the audience here. There's an obvious difference between a singularity and a miracle. And I think it would be embarrassing to try and explain it. It would be patronizing to try.
Since you gave your turn away, Mr. Hitchens, I'll ask you first. If the questioner asks, if God does not exist, what then is the purpose of life?
Well, I can only answer for myself. What cheers me up? I suppose mainly gloating over the misfortunes of other people. I guess that.
And you say evil comes from religion.
I guess that has to be. I think mainly crowing over the miseries of others. It doesn't always work, but it never completely fails. And then there's irony. There's irony, and which is the gin in the Campari, the cream in the coffee. Sex can have diminishing returns, but it's amazing. No, that's pretty much it, and then it's a clear run to the grave. But raising the sights just a fraction, I'd say that what matters most is the pursuit of happiness, in the words of our greatest founding father, and the pursuit of liberty, freedom, and that these things are incompatible, completely incompatible with the worship of an unalterable celestial dictator, someone who can watch you while you sleep and convict you of thought crime, and whose rule cannot be challenged, and who's the big brother whose eternal reign may not be disputed. That makes the concept of the pursuit of freedom and happiness completely negative, negates it. So one of the things I live for is to return a stout and joyful non-serviam to this dictator who I'm pleased to find
doesn't really exist, but is instead a creation of those who want to install a theocracy in the real life where I can participate, and I'm not going to give them an inch. The second thing I live for is, if not exactly passing on my genes, taking part in activities that might allow those genes to be passed on. And not... not scorning the three delightful children who result, who are everything to me and who are my only chance of even a glimpse of a second life, let alone an immortal one. And I'll tell you something, if I was told to sacrifice them to prove my devotion to God, if I was told to do what all monotheists are told to do and admire the man who said, yes, I'll gut my kid to show my love of God, I'd say, no, fuck you.
Thank
and
you,
so should you, and the religions that say you should admire infanticide as proof of the love of God have no claim at all to be preaching ethics, let alone morality.